Hello everyone and welcome. In this video we are talking about V5 engines, something there aren't very many of out there. Honda actually made a V5 engine for motorcycle racing and they were actually super successful with it. And Volkswagen has what they call a V5 engine they used in the 90s and early 2000s. It's actually more appropriately would be called a VR5 engine. So that's what we're going to be talking about in this video, the AGZ 2.3-liter VR5 engine out of Volkswagen. And really what it is just a VR6 engine and you've chopped off one of the cylinders. So if you were to look at the block here, you've got three on the right, two on the left, and your cylinders are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Easy enough. Then your firing order, which is kind of interesting, 1, 2, 4, 5, 3. So it just goes in this clockwise circle here as it rotates around and you get your power and everything. So it's interesting, you know, Volkswagen, I guess, decided, you know, the VR6 is too big and too powerful for some cars, and an inline 4 just isn't quite enough. So this sits nicely in between. And did at the time, as far as power output, the first one only producing 150 horsepower, but it was still a little bit more than the inline four cylinder at the time. And they eventually went to four valves per cylinder instead of just two valves per cylinder, and improved output to something like 170 horsepower for the 2.3 liter. Pretty interesting. And actually this firing order is the same as an inline five cylinder. So it's a lot like an inline five cylinder, except it just kind of smashed into the wall and all the cylinders got bunched up. But from you know, a dynamic standpoint, how it works, things like that, it is pretty similar to an inline five-cylinder engine. It just does have a single valve train up on top, which is a cool thing about the engine that Volkswagen has done with these VR engines. So this is a poor sketch of what that looks like, but you've got a camshaft on one side for the intakes, you've got a camshaft on the other side for the exhaust, and it will stretch over and, you know, activate that intake on one side, activate the intake on this side, depending on where those pistons are. And one of the interesting things looking at this engine here, so it's at a 15 degree angle. And because of that angle and because these cylinders are so close together, you can imagine that as those cylinders are bored down, as you follow that bore down into the cylinder, those cylinders, you don't want them to overlap or contact each other. You want some space between there for coolant jackets, things like that. Of course, you just need some metal between the cylinders. And so they had to offset the cylinders, so they had to push them out a little bit in order to do that. And as a result, the interesting thing is that the center line of the cylinder does not line up with the center line of the crankshaft. And that's pretty much the case with other engines, an inline engine or a V engine, you'll have that center line of the cylinder match up with the center of the crankshaft. And that keeps kind of a smooth, even motion as that piston goes up and down as far as how it rotates. It's a little bit different, but it's almost the same going up and coming down. Versus with this engine here, it's actually going to be quite different, you know, as it's going up there versus as it's going around here. So it's got a kind of weird motion as it's going up and down, a different motion, you know, for going up versus going down with regard to this crankshaft here, but just kind of an interesting design feature there. I'm sure that's something that, you know, makes it a bit more challenging to balance. Another thing that's interesting about this engine is how they've oriented the cylinders. So they've kind of flipped them around on the other side of the engine. So you've got your intake valve on the right, on the right, on the right, and then they're flipped over on the other side of the engine. So now it's on the left and on the left. And so you've just got your intake manifold on one side of the engine, you've got your exhaust manifold on the other side of the engine, and then within the cylinder head, you can see you've got these paths. So it allows you to pair up two of the intake valves together, pair up two of the exhaust valves together as it's exiting the engine within that cylinder head. Makes it a little bit simpler within the cylinder head to have this design when you have those cylinders switched on the other side so you can pair up the intake and exhaust valves. It is a bit weird though. I mean, think about it, you've got five cylinders and two of the cylinders out of those five have a longer distance for the intake air to travel, and then two of those cylinders have a shorter distance for the exhaust air to travel. So, you know, it's a little wonky, it's a little strange. Now, it's also interesting to think about from a balancing perspective. You've got two, you know, cylinders going up and down on the left, you've got three cylinders going up and down on the right, and an inline five cylinder actually isn't that poor of a design from a balance perspective. It has a rocking moment where, you know, the engine itself kind of wants to rock back and forth along that line. But, you know, ultimately it's a fairly smooth running engine. This, however, you've now split that up. So you've got different forces going this direction and this direction because you've got different number of cylinders, so you've got a different mass on each side, and you can counter a good amount of this using your crankshaft design and having counterweights that balance that out. But ultimately, there's probably going to be some kind of unique vibrations that are associated with an engine like this. So, you know, what's the logic of it? Well, again, it's that happy medium. And at the time, it may have made sense to do. Of course, it was killed by the inline four-cylinder turbocharged engine. Like a lot of cool engines out there, it's, you know, I guess unfortunate, but it's not all that logical. It's neat to kind of look back, though, and see something as strange as this that actually made it into production. You know, there are still, I'm sure, cars with these running around out there. So kind of cool. I'm sure it has a unique sound as well, that kind of an inline five-cylinder sound to it, but with different, you know, length exhaust. So it's got some unique characteristics to it for sure. So thank you all for watching. And if you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave those below.